All right, everybody, good morning. Good morning. It's good to see you all here this morning. Nice to have everyone here. Welcome to 1111. I see some visitors. That's good to see you all here as well. Welcome online. I'm glad to have you. I'm Tom McDermott, the host of this thing and pastor of the community. I'm really glad to see you online as well as to see you all here. Register attendance, do all that kind of stuff. And I want a couple of quick announcements. I just heard also that that CTL, the Center for Transforming Lives, is they have a resale shop, and every now and then we bring stuff over and contribute to that resale shop. So if you have things at home that you could contribute, bring them during the week, and you can leave them downstairs at the front desk, and that will go towards their resale shop. Appreciate that very much, doing that. If you're here for the first time, we have a tumbler for you in the back that is our 1111 tumbler. We'd love for you to take that with you. And then also, it is UMW Sunday, and one of our United Methodist women and one of our one of their representatives is also one of our favorite folks. And so I'm going to invite Sharm Robarts to come up and to say a word about the United Methodist women.
Everybody, this is an announcement just for women, but the men can listen. So 100 years ago, 1924, a group of women in this church, I can't even imagine what Fort Worth was like in 1924, but these women looked out in the community and saw that for what was relatively new thing was happening, and that is that women were having to join the workforce. The economy was bad, and so our women said, we need to help out with the kids. So they organized and began to educate and care for the children of these women who were, you know, having quite a change of life. Well, here we are 100 years later, still in business as the United Methodist Women. There's 400 of us now, and we are divided into small circles. And so I'm here today to invite you, if you have any interest at all in becoming a part of a service and friendship organization, I'd be glad to tell you more about it. I won't take up any more of your time, but you can find information on the website and certainly ask me, and maybe there's some others in here who are in UMW who would answer questions. So thanks. That's it. I'll just lay it right here.
Thank you, Sharon.
Okay, so really quickly, we are in number three, stage three of perplexity of the four stages of faith, looking at Brian McLaren's book, Faith After Doubt, and just exploring that reality. And I would say really that 1111, who we've been and who our community is, has really pretty much always existed in that perplexity stage. But and as well as when we move to stage four, which is harmony, it's an interesting kind of what we call stage two, which what Richard would call it, he would call it the second half of spirituality or second half spirituality as opposed to the first. So we'll talk more about that. And I've got a song that we chose. Brad and I thought about this song. I think it deals with perplexity. But even more than that, I think the whole song itself is perplexing. So I just don't want to say much more about American Woman, except that, number one, it's not about a woman. In case you've always thought that that's what that song was about. And number two is to think about your own story, because this song is really about a story. And where is your story in your faith journey? And more than that, how much larger could that story be?
From being American woman, mama let me be. Don't come hanging around my door, I don't wanna see your face no more. I got more important things to do than spend my time growing old with you. Now woman, stay away. American woman, listen what I say. American woman, get away from me. American woman, mama let me be. Don't come hanging round my door, I don't wanna see your shadow no more. colored lights can hypnotize, sparkle someone else's eyes. Now, woman, get away. American woman, listen what I say. Said, get away. American woman, listen what I say. Don't come hanging round my door. I don't wanna see your face no more. I don't need your war machines. I don't need your ghetto scenes. Colored lights can hypnotize, sparkle someone else's eyes. Now, woman, get away. American woman, listen what I say. American woman, get away from me. American woman, mama, let me be. I gotta go, gotta get away. Babe, I gotta go, gonna fly away.
Wow. Welcome to 1111, where we have an amazing band. Part of my story, Tom, my faith story, I've always been taught that God's kind of love includes everybody. And I think including people means welcoming people. And so to everyone here and everyone online, the candle, our welcome candle is lit, and I would say welcome. We are so very, very glad you're here. And every Sunday we do welcome words together. So would you join me? Come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving. It does not matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times, come yet again.
Thank you, Margaret. Beautifully said. 1111, I would like for y'all to stand now and sing a good old solid hymn with us, if you would. Elena's going to lead this one. Lyrics are on the screen. And it's also the time to bring your offering on up to the table. Sing with us.
God of movement, work inside us. Send your rain and nurture us all. Tend our roots and hearts, excite us. Help us hear your ancient call. In our pain and in our laughter, present ever.
Verse 2, here we go.
As a tiny seed is planted, roots emerge and growth begins. So we ask our hearts enchanted, bring your kingdom forth from within. Love unquenchable, hope unstoppable, reign of justice with no end. Use our life.
Verse 3.
Send us forth to sow and scatter seeds that grow your kingdom on earth. Make it clear the ways that matter, those which bring new life and new birth.
Finish.
Evermore your kingdom revealing. Now's the time to plant and sow.
That was lovely, lovely, lovely. You can now take a moment and offer one another a sign of peace, please.
Today's scripture reading is from Genesis. In the course of the night, Jacob arose, took the entire caravan, and crossed the ford of Yabbok. And after that, Jacob had crossed with all of his possessions. He returned to camp, and he was completely alone. And there, someone wrestled with Jacob until the first light of day. Seeing that Jacob could not be overpowered, the other one stuck Jacob at the socket of his hip, and the hip was dislocated as they wrestled. When Jacob the contender said, "Let me go, the day is breaking." When Jacob's contender said, "Let me go, the day is breaking," Jacob answered, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." "What is your name?" the other asked. "Jacob," he answered. The other said, "Your name will no longer be called Jacob, or heel grabber, but Israel, overcomer of God, because you have wrestled both with God and mortality, and you have prevailed." Then Jacob asked, "Now tell me your name, I beg you." And the other said, "Why do you ask my name?" and blessed him.
I'm going to invite y'all to sing another song with us while you're seated. It's a song that we wrote especially for the service. Here we go. It goes like this.
If I were to pray, if I were to pray, in the breaking of the morning or the dying of the day, what would I say? What would I say? What would my heart speak if I were to pray? If I were to sing, if I were to sing, if my soul could give some honest offering, what would I bring? What would I bring? What are the simple truths my soul would want to say? And if I do, will not the earth bend near? Will not the sacred life in all creation turn to lend an ear? Will not my song throughout the cosmos ring? Swim that crystal river that flows through everything.
Bird snake.
If I were to pray, if I were to pray, in the breaking of the morning or the dying of the day, what would I say? What would I say? What would my heart speak if I were to pray?
I always find that song to be so lovely and peaceful. Thank you. Good morning. I'm Cynthia Powell, and I'm delighted to be guiding the Kairos moment this morning. And I'd like to start with an excerpt from Daily Word, and it's World Peace. So peace in my heart is my gift to the world. Today I envision a peaceful world. I imagine harmony and cooperation inspiring the minds and hearts of all people. Like a lake that has been disturbed momentarily by movement, I see fear and anger dissipating, ripples fading into the distance as the surface of the water becomes still. Calm engenders calm, and peace grows. Compassion fills every heart. I begin this important work by searching within myself for simmering resentments, judgments, and unkindness. And with compassion, I forgive myself, softening the hardened parts of my heart. From this place, I need not wish for peace, because I bring peace. As each heart softens and opens to include all others, peace will blanket the earth. I now invite you to be in a comfortable position and either close your eyes or gently lower your gaze if you feel a little bit more comfortable. And just taking a moment to tune into your breathing, just sensing the breathing within the body. Perhaps allowing a sense of peace to gently shower you. Perhaps setting an intention on how you can spread peace through this beautiful world of ours. And as we bring this Kairos moment to a close, one of my favorite quotes from Eleanor Roosevelt I'd like to share with you. The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams.
Thank you, Cynthia. And thank you, Sharm, for reading that text as well. It's one of my favorite stories, the famous wrestling match of Jacob in the Old Testament book of Genesis. We've got some new technology here, so we're going to see if I can have some fun with it, if it works. So the other thing I wanted to say, Leslie, right off the start. So you saw that the song was not about a woman, right? That came through. You're going like, no, it still felt like a woman. It's an American woman, still was like a woman. Yeah. Except that the guests who are from Canada, right? It was the 1960s, late 1960s when the song came out. Talking about the sparkling streets, the sparkling stuff, and the ghetto streets, and the war machines. Is that a woman? I mean, can be sometimes, I guess, but... So he's really talking about America, the larger story of sort of materialism and war and conflict in the 60s, where there was kind of this counter movement of peace and love that was going on. And we're really talking about this idea of perplexity. What's the larger story and what's the pushback? What's the wrestling match that's going on with the larger story? In our own faith journeys, there's often this larger story of this wrestling match. So I wanted to start off very quickly with a story that most of you, a lot of you will remember, but it seems very appropriate to our theme today since we're talking about a river. And it does concern the Rabbi Baal Shem Tov, who is the founder of the Hasidic faith. And when he was dying, he was at his deathbed, and his disciples were gathered around him. But other people had heard that he was going to die, and so they wanted to gather around him too for the perfect piece of information, because we all understand that part of our faith journey is in mastering the information of our faith, right? And becoming better and better and skilled at it, what we call stage two Christianity, sort of this idea of discipleship, being exactly what we're supposed to be, as we learned in stage one. And so all the disciples were gathered around because they wanted that piece of information. But he was dying, and so the head disciple, the one who had been closest to him and studied with him the longest, was there and said, "We're all gathered, Rabbi. We want to know something. Share with us the essence of life. What is the meaning of it all?" And then the rabbi looked up with weak eyes and barely got the phrase out, "Life is like a river." And then he closed his eyes and he kind of went into a daze. And the disciple pondered it for a moment. He didn't want to pass it along incorrectly. And then he turned to the disciple next to him and he said, "The Rebbe, Master said, life is like a river. Pass it along." And so it went around the room quietly. Life is like a river. Each one pondering very, very sacredly, very, very honoring in this moment. Life is like a river. Of course it is. Life is like a river. Well, then it went around the room. It went out the door, down the hallway. Life is like a river. And he passed it to the next one. Life is like a river. And then it was with more determination as it got further and further, because people began to ponder. Life is like a river. Life flows. You have to move with the flow. And they had sort of interpretations by the time it went out the door and down the street. There were more and more questions about it, though. What do you mean life is like a river? By the time it got to the end of the line where the crowd had gathered down the street, someone said, ask the Rebbe, what does he mean life is like a river? I mean, it's such a vague, generalized statement. What does he mean life is like a river? And so the question came back, what does the Rebbe mean? What does the Rebbe mean? And when it got all the way back into the house, what does the Rebbe mean? It went all the way around the bed until it got back to the lead disciple. Ask the Rebbe, what does he mean? And so they leaned over to the Rebbe, and the Baal Shem Tov was barely clinging on with a last gasp of breath, and they said, Rebbe, I'm so sorry, but Rebbe, they don't understand. What do you mean life is like a river? And the Rebbe looked up with his last gasp of air and said, who knows? Maybe it's not. So we have this idea that we come to stage one and stage two faith. That's what we were talking about the last 2 weeks. And most churches, as Richard Rohr spoke of the first half of life, or the first sort of first life, first half spirituality, it's this idea of sort of finding out what do we need to know, what specifics, what kind of very concrete ideas. And so we deal with dualisms, right and wrong, God and Satan, good and evil, us and them. We're in the group, we're out, those people are outside, but we want them to be with us so they can be like what we think. So it's very much oriented around very specific, concrete ideas. Most of us got this when we were kids in Sunday school, perhaps, or maybe passed along from our family or our community, where we mostly inherit our spiritual heritage of sorts. And sometimes very loosely so that the most we know is that we've heard about the story of the of creation, at least one of them, maybe both of them. We get them all mixed up until we actually get into stage two. But then we know the basics, and so we look to our authorities, the preachers and the district superintendents and the priests or whatever your religious background, and we look to them for the answers. So it's pretty concrete, pretty basic. But then as we want to become more mature, more responsible, we want to kind of find our own independence and master these skills, then we enter into stage two, where we're really learning more about the pragmatic aspects of what it means. And if stage one is faith before doubt, stage two is faith navigating doubt or negotiating doubt, managing it. And so we start thinking in terms of questions, and then we find those answers, and we look to those resources that sort of confirm those answers. If it's a strength that's enthusiastic and it's action-oriented and it's very much leadership-oriented, if it's a weakness, though, it's the fact that it can be very superficial after a while. You can kind of start wondering, well, is that all there is? And then you start having questions that start to arise about what about this or what about that? Or I heard there's four gospels. Why are the four gospels not the same? Why is John so different from the other gospels? Oh, and then you find out, oh, they were written at very different times, sometimes as much as 75 years apart. They had completely different communities, completely different parts of the area. The temple had fallen. What did that mean when the country was essentially overthrown, when Judaism was completely overthrown and everyone scattered? Oh, wait, that was going on too? So you start asking questions. You find out all these different things. And now the idea of the infallibility of Scripture, or the idea of God removed and somewhere out there intervening, and now the idea of mirror, everything starts to come up for question. Now most churches and most Christians, honestly, are in stage one and two Christian faith. They're in that place of simplicity or complexity. But think about our country too. Because this is the way a lot of us operate in terms of our societies. We operate wanting things very specific. We don't like change. We like to get in familiar patterns. We find ourselves in contrasting realities. And then over time, we find ourselves in very concrete binaries. Those who are against us, those who are with us, Republican, Democrat, conservative liberals, we find ourselves falling into almost stage one simplicity life. And when we try to get more complex with it, we're really just moving into stage two. Because perplexity is where nobody likes to be. It's the hardest place to be. It's confusing and it's challenging to be there. The Rabbi Baal Shem Tov once told his students, I love this story, I'm just going to read it to you really quickly. He once told some of his students who were asking him about how people learn and trying to get this idea of non-duality. Because what you have in perplexity when you get there is, let's see if this comes up. Yeah. Oh, by the way, it's going to be perplexing just to even read what I put on these screens. You know, I knew I was going to have this technology. I didn't know what it was going to look like. And since I'm not the one who normally designs these things, I was just sort of flying by the seat of my pants. So I love using an Escher drawing behind it to illustrate perplexity with all these possible different directions in how we understand things. But at the same time, you can't really read what it says. When unraveling is the path that we're traveling. Perplexity is faith that is in doubt. It's not simply managing doubt. It is literally in doubt. And so here's what the Rabbi Belshemtov was talking to his students back in, this would be back in the 17th century when the Hasidic faith was being formed. And he said, the Hasidic master, Rabbi Nachman of Breslov said, evil is opposition. For example, whatever contradicts a person's will is evil. But in a state of oneness, in a state of non-duality, which is something that is really hard to put your head around, in a state of non-duality, opposition does not exist. Now, you're sitting here going like, no, opposition exists, all right. It's out there. I see it on Facebook. I see it on X, the former Twitter, all the time. I see it all the time out in my culture, out in the society, in my encounters with some of my... Yeah, there's a lot of opposition. Nope. Rabbi Nachman of Breslov said, in a state of oneness, opposition does not exist. Rather, everything is good and evil has no place. So it was with this understanding that the Belshemtov then, the founder of the Hasidic movement, offered a novel interpretation when he said, there are four types of students who go to the study hall. One goes to the study hall but does not study, and yet he gains the rewards of going. Two, one goes to study but does not go, he gains the rewards of studying. A third type of student is the one who goes and studies and he becomes pious. The fourth one is the one who neither goes nor studies and he is wicked. So they said, how can the fourth person, the wicked, be counted among the four who go to the study hall? And the Belshemtov said, when he neither goes to or no go, neither goes or studies. He asked them, how can this be? He's not involved in the process at all. And he answered with this famous phrase, evil is a setting for good. Now you got to wrap your heads around that, folks. You really have to wrap your head around the idea that conflict is a setting for redemption. That those problems that we deal with or that we're faced with are invitations for redemption. For wholeness, and that evil itself is actually a place where good exists. That's the idea behind non-duality, and it's really challenging to try to wrap your heads around that. I liken it to this slide here. Let's see if I can pull this up here. Y'all try to see if you can guess why I'm using these different slides in the background. Y'all recognize that? Now, none of you watched The Matrix, did you? A few of you watched The Matrix. Okay, so this was in The Matrix, but I love this idea. Church life has run its course. What happens in the period of perplexity is we find that church life has run its course. We're in a crisis of faith or perhaps a crisis of community. For example, perhaps there's an impropriety of the pastor or there's some kind of somebody stole a lot of funds or there's some kind of community conflict where you've got the right and the left. When I was in a church south of Dallas, I remember that it was my first church to pastor. I entered into what you could literally consider one of the most dysfunctional environments. I had worked at the state hospital working with psychotic patients and worked at the drug rehabilitation, and they were easier to deal with. The complexities of these patterns were so entrenched that when I walked in, I realized, oh my gosh, I've walked into this seriously codependent, dysfunctional reality right and left. And my wife, of course, was trying to deal with this. Me, I was going like, oh, I'm familiar with this territory. I've been here before. I grew up in it. I know this reality. But I was dealing with something that a lot of folks could not see. And what I found myself trying to deal with was how to help folks see what was so hard for us to see once we're entrenched in our pattern. And that's why perplexity is such a difficult place to be, because once we're challenged with this idea that maybe it's not what we think it is, maybe it's bigger, maybe it's not, maybe God's not out there, maybe God's not out there at all, maybe God's right here in everything, maybe we're part of God, maybe we're not recognizing our own potential divinity. I mean, that's hard to start wrapping your head around when you're entrenched in your familiar territory of right and wrong, and they're wrong. There's no God over there. They don't got no God. They don't even understand God. God is love. So you see how challenging it can be. And I found myself in this difficult situation because both people who were running for sheriff were in my church. Both of them would take me out to lunch on a regular basis. And tell me, being a four, and you know on the Enneagram, fours have to deal with, fours are all about authenticity. We don't like deceit, you know, so we sort of gravitate towards exposing things that feel like deceitful or inconsistent. I mean, even if we're not sure we know the answer, we'll open it up and go, anybody else got an idea? Where else, where some people are like, I did not want to look at that, and they're gone. Fours aren't always the best people to live with. You can ask my wife. So I had the sheriffs both there. We had communion one Sunday, and I could not help it. I literally could not. I stopped for a moment as they kneeled at the rail. And I said, isn't it interesting how we forget who we are and what we're about when we've come to this rail, which is our unified sense of what love is after the example of Jesus. And yet, once we move from this rail, we become vindictive and argumentative and pointing fingers and vitriolic. And both of the sheriffs, or the potential sheriffs, looked up at me. And wasn't smiling. And one of the families left the church. And I didn't, of course, advocate for either one. I wasn't going to do that. But it was a perfect example of why this place's perplexity is so difficult. Because perplexity invites us to do what Jacob had to do. And the Jacob story is so profound and so archetypal for us, because we find ourselves in these places all the time. As individuals, when we're facing a deeper shadow aspect of who we are and having to deal with that, whether it was Jacob and his brother Esau, and how he stole his birthright, and then how he manipulated the family, and then how he manipulated the community, and then when he found himself now heading towards this new land, and here comes his brother, and he knows what his brother's going to be about now. Years and years and years later, his brother has an army, and they're coming. So he's at the River Jabbok. Which, by the way, the River Jabbok means crossroads. Ding, ding, ding. Right? How do we deal with these times when we find ourselves? So this place of being in perplexity is challenging, to say the least. It's one thing if we start to change our clothes. It's another thing, and trust me, it takes a lot for me to want to change something at all, much less, you know, something deep and psychic and profound in my relationship or in my own sense of who I am. It takes a lot to change the way I tell my story. I think that's true for all of us. It's another thing to change our car and our home or have to move. Those are difficult, or even jobs are difficult. But changing our mind is one of the most difficult things of all, which is why we do the mindfulness practices, which is why we do some of these other simple little practices we talk about in terms of trying to open ourselves up to a different way of seeing things. When we finally get down to it, if we're willing to go there, this is where we end up. We end up in the desert. This was the place where I had my retreat when I took my time off, my time of leave a couple of years ago out in the desert of New Mexico. And I looked out there one day at this desert and I thought, this is the ugliest, most dull place I've ever been. I mean, it was winter, it was brown, and it was a little tiny stucco adobe place in the middle of this desert about 100 yards from a tiny little Catholic monastery. Of course, nobody was out then either because it was COVID, so you didn't see anybody. And so I was just here, me and then this Wiccan woman who was two doors down at her little hut, and we basically practicing and meditating and burning incense and, you know, doing witchy stuff. Which I thought was fascinating, but we never did talk that much. But I was in this place of perplexity. And when you get to a place of perplexity, what do you find yourself thinking? If you've gotten to that place where you've questioned everything, you tend to do one of two things. You tend to dive in and start digging in more, or you tend to sort of dismiss it, or you absolutely reject it outright. And so life is either a joke, or it's a mystery, or it becomes an invitation. And by what I mean by mystery is we just sort of don't know. So we just sort of take things as they come, and we don't engage too much with the questions. But the invitation says, are you willing to get messy? I mean, your brain. Are you willing to really mix it up? Wrestle with it. And then God becomes a myth that we've kind of outgrown. Or, like Nietzsche, opiate of the people. Or perhaps even more, something more profound, a mystery that we start to seek, that we're willing to seek. But here's the thing. Here's the heresy that I want to suggest, of course. Y'all aren't going to be surprised by this. Maybe you will be online. I don't know. But if we say God is not out there, then what are we actually seeking? If God is not out there, but God is in all things, if God is with me and I'm part of God, if God is not even what we think of as God, that's just a word which carries so much linguistic baggage and neurological patterning that it's hard to even think of anything else but God is something that we grew up with. But what if, in fact, it is the very best, the most redemptive possibility at the heart of who we are and all of our moments? Then what does it mean to actually seek that? Because it's already here. We're just not paying attention. Or maybe we're not inviting it in the conflict. The opposite of faith isn't doubt. The opposite of faith feels like it ought to be certainty. I'm sorry, I got that wrong. The opposite is faith is not doubt, but certainty. The opposite of faith is certainty. And that's a challenge for us, because stage one and stage two were all about certainty. The opposite of fear is not courage. The opposite of fear is curiosity. But that's hard to get to because we're used to being afraid. So the challenge in perplexity is to go places where we aren't comfortable going, and that's a real difficulty. You're not going to be able to see what I wrote up there. It says, turn to your shadow and join the dance of life. That's really hard. How do we face the most difficult things that we're dealing with in our culture today? How do we face the most difficult things we're dealing with in our church today? Our church, which is deciding, rather than face this challenge, what is it deciding to do? Those who are facing this shadow are retreating back to stage one, Christianity. Maybe some in stage two, but even stage two is at least willing to start asking questions. Most are retreating back to the very basics, because that idea of faith and fear are so caught up in each other that it has nothing to do with faith. It has more to do with a codependency. How do I assuage my anxiety? I'll just stick around to something concrete and find as many people to agree with me as I can. That's the challenge. Facing the shadow is really challenging for us. It's very hard. But what I find in this story with Jacob is this possibility of what can happen when we do face our shadow. And what I want to suggest is that this shadow that we have to face goes way back to Augustine and to Aristotle and to the early church as it became more empire-oriented. Because the minute something becomes empire-oriented, and the Roman Empire colonializing, all of that, the moment it becomes oriented around power is the moment that it stays very stuck in concrete and rules. Because that's how you control things. That's how you keep things in place. Progressively, that's also how things eventually fall away, which is why Brian McLaren would say, we have as many as 65 million people now that have abandoned church over the last several decades. And the church is shrinking more and more, little by little, because of some of these challenges to our own shadow that we can't deal with. So what we have that's been around because of this story that we've told of the fall of Genesis, for example, where woman and man, I mean, Adam is there, and then Eve comes along and tempts Adam, and snake had tempted Eve, and now we've got Adam sinning, he ate from the tree of knowledge, and then we have Augustine who says, well, that's where we all fell from grace, and that's where we all sin, and now we have to have Jesus as a sacrifice so that we can get back close to God, because God can't bear to be around things that are sinful, right? Now, concretely, that makes perfect sense. But in terms of our relationships, in terms of life itself, it makes no sense. that you have to kill something in order to love something. But that's what we have. And it's infiltrated everything in terms of how we see culture. So we have this patriarchy and flawed nature of the feminine. That's one of the great things we get from that whole 1,500 years of church history and where we are today. We have being human is bad, and that we're separate from one another. We have that idea that we are separate from what is sacred in our very midst and separate from what is sacred in the one with whom we feel opposition because of this story. And we have the path to peace as requiring violence, which is just the Roman Empire all over again. And so how do we face this perplexity, this time of perplexity? Well, you can see it's already happening, right? It's not happening always necessarily in the church, but it's happening around us. We saw it happening at the turn of right around COVID time. We saw it happening finally with the murder of George Floyd. We saw it happening prior to that with women coming out. I was in the feminist movement in the 1970s. You'd have thought that it never happened until the mid-90s with the Me Too movement. But there was a skip of generations, and patriarchy kind of fell right back into place. So now women had independence, they just had more independence being more of what patriarchy thought women ought to be. And then women started coming, conscious about it. I mean, really starting to recognize the realities, the patterns, and the voices started coming out. You had the Me Too movement. You had Black Lives Matter. You have the Church Too movements. You have all of these conflicts going on, and at the same time, you have the pushback of the idea of concrete, of keeping things simple, of keeping things in stage one. So you have ICE, and you have the police being more aggressive. You have politics on the right being more aggressive, because that's what happens in this kind of perplexity. You have questioning, and you have massive pushback. And the challenge for us, I think, as people of faith who are in this place of perplexity, and I would like to think people who are moving more and more towards harmony, is that we start to practice seeing the good that is embedded in the evil. That we already see the conflict as the place where good is, where potentiality is, where love, in fact, is. And that's really hard to get there, I agree. One of my favorite quotes came from a guy by the name of Rainer Maria Wilke, who said, maybe I'll read the poem next week, but he was talking about this idea of wrestling. Rainer Maria Wilke grew up in a family where his mother had lost their daughter when she was 3. So when Rainer was born, she really wanted a daughter. So she and her husband treated him as a girl, dressed him as a girl, treated him as a girl, until he was 12 years of age. When his father came back from not working at the war, he worked for the war, but he wasn't in the war as a soldier. When he finally came back, he could see sort of the confusion of this and sent Rainer off to military school. Yeah, it was hard. You can imagine. And yet out of that conflict, out of that perplexity, Rainer Maria Wilke wrote some of the most beautiful, some of the most profound transformative poetry you will ever have read. One of them being, of course, this idea of living in the midst of the questions. That when the questions come, you don't go for the answer. You don't immediately run to the easy. You sit with the question. And in time, the question itself becomes the path. What a beautiful idea for someone who lived the way in the life that he had to live in. And then he wrote this idea in his poem. He had this phrase that I want to suggest to you. As the poem comes to end, he's speaking about Jacob and the angel, and he says, "Whoever was overcome by this angel, who so often declined the fight, he strides upright and justified, and great out of that hard hand, which as if sculpting nestled around him, this man winning does not tempt him." That was not the point. His growth comes by being deeply defeated by ever greater things. That idea of growing by being defeated as opposed to winning. That's really what perplexity invites us into, is a space of humility, generosity, forgiveness, much like Jesus' own life. If you think about Jesus as being sacrificial lamb, you miss the point. If there was ever a model for someone who was defeated by ever greater things, it was Jesus, who was always looking at the larger story to redefine the small story. And that's what we're invited to do. So the band's going to come out here, and I'm going to put this last image up here. One of my favorite, Michael Lunig, who's a great poet as well as a great artist. Let it go, let it all unravel. And it will be a path. Let me see if I can get it exactly right, because I always forget it. Let it go, let it out, let it all unravel. Let it free, and it can be a path on which to travel. Billy Joel wrote this next song, River of Dreams. It was the last song he ever wrote. A lot of people don't know that. It was on his last album. He's continued to perform, but it was the last song that he ever wrote. And when someone asked him about why he had written it, he grew up Jewish. He dismissed his Jewish faith. And yet he said himself at one point, I lost my faith in my own judgment and a lot of old values. And this is a lot of what the dilemma is on this album, he says. A loss of faith in a lot of things and a desire to find a new way to find it and affirm it. And so he wrote this song about having a dream in the middle of the night. This river, where we find ourselves often in these conflicts, whether they're small and it just has to do with what we're reading online, or it has to do with somebody that's texting us something that's just further feeding the conflict because they can't see the love in the opposition. They can't see the possibilities there, the redemptive possibility. And our tendency is to want to jump on board, and yet we're at a crossroads. That's the river right there. It's an invitation. Do we simply plow right through it, or do we sit with it for a while and find another way, dream of another way of being hope and positive and loving and generous, even in these most tense and vitriolic realities? That's what we're invited to. The way that John O'Donohue wrote it, he said, if I were to do anything and wish for my life one thing, it would be to learn to flow like a river, so that I could feed what's beside me and be a part of its unfolding in the process.
In the middle of the night, I go walking in my sleep. From the mountains of fading to the river so deep. I must be looking for something, something sacred I lost. But the river is wide and it's too hard to cross. Even though I know the river is wide, I walk down every evening and walk to the shore. To the opposite side till I can finally find what I've been looking for. In the middle of the night, I go walking in my sleep, through the valley of fear, to the river so deep. I've been searching for something, taken out of my soul, something I would never lose, something somebody stole, yeah. I'm tired and I don't want to walk anymore. Hope it doesn't be the rest of my life till I can find what it is I've been looking for. In the middle of the night, I'm walking in my sleep, through the jungle of doubts, to a river so deep. I know I'm searching for something, something so undefined. It can only be seen by the eyes of the blind. In the middle of the night. Ooh, yeah. I'm not sure of my life, but this God knows I've never been.
been a spiritual man. Baptized by the fire, raided to the river, thirst to the promised land. In the middle of the night, I go walking in my sleep through the desert of truth, to the river so deep. We all end in the ocean. We all start in the streams. Coming along to the river of dreams. In the middle of the night.
I hope you were looking at those words, because the words exactly, I mean, Billy Joel professes to be an atheist, and yet I couldn't think of anyone more holy and more sanctified and more on a journey of spirituality than those lyrics right there. And I'm going to mess with you even a little bit more, and sorry for those of you who are first-time visitors here, you have to go put this together later on. But you know, the other day I happened to stumble onto something that completely turned me upside down. I stumbled on the website for the Satanic Temple. Yeah. Does it even feel weird that I would say that in here? Yeah, it feels weird as a man of God saying that. Here's their first tenet. One should strive to act with compassion and empathy toward all creatures in accordance with reason. Oh, you got to read the rest of them. But the point is not that maybe they chose that. I mean, there's different groups of satanic folks and all that kind of thing. And we're unfortunately stuck in, again, the archetypal disaster because of that initial story that the church and the empire reigned upon culture and society for hundreds of years, that we are stuck in this dualistic nightmare of them and us and bad and good. When Rabbi Belshemtov and the earliest Jews in the 15th, 17th century were already talking about the reality that you can't pin God down as a thing. It's the very reality of goodness and love and hope and redemption in everything. Cosmic order, ground of being, call it what you want. It's in everything. How do we participate in that? How do we help others see that? It's going to be hard. But that's the reason why this is such a great conspiracy to be in here, is because if we can really tap into that, you're changing yourself if you're not changing the world around you too. Which is why, as we stand, we say together, just the first phrase, go in pieces. We'll see you next week as we talk about harmony.